We live in a consumer society. Shopping has become a part of most people's daily or weekly routine, whether it be for food or clothing or, thanks in large part to the internet and human creativity, almost anything you can think of. Also, thanks to the ubiquity of the market economy, the process of shopping is fairly similar everywhere. But what did that process look like in the Soviet Union, which operated a command economy? What could people buy and what kinds of stores were there? Were shortages real or a part of Western propaganda? I'm your host, David, and today we are going to look at the Soviet shopping experience. This is the Cold War. Okay, just to establish this up front, the Soviet Union employed a centrally planned command economy. This obviously resulted in a different shopping experience than what would be encountered in a country employing a free market economy. With private enterprise and businesses being prohibited in the USSR, but goods still needing to be produced, the result was one or two state-run enterprises responsible for producing those goods based on plans ordered by the central government. So, what was the direct impact and result from that? Well, unlike in the West, where there could be dozens of not only brand selections, but even choices in size and flavor of, say, toothpaste, in the Soviet Union, there would be maybe two choices of brand and little to no choice in flavor and format. With no competition, there was little incentive to differentiate the product and provide choices to consumers. Now, let's talk about the shopping experience itself. For a Soviet citizen who lived in a major city, shopping centers, resembling modern malls, were a possible option, offering a variety of different products. The stores created by the Soviet government and called Central Universal Department Stores, or CUM, existed in the major cities, including the capitals of each of the republics. The first opened in Moscow in 1922 after the nationalization of the Muir and Muralist Department Store in Tverskoy District, located on what was known at the time as Sverdlov Ploshad, or Square, now Teatralnaya Ploshad. These CUM stores, especially after the growth of light industry following the Second World War, and even more so after the death of Stalin, began to carry goods with a reputation for being higher in quality, although the prices were higher along with that reputation. Other than the CUM stores, and far more widely available to consumers, were the State Universal Department Stores, or GUM stores. GUMs, like CUMs, resembled modern-day shopping malls, with the first one opened in 1923. In the years after the Great Patriotic War, again like the CUMs, the GUMs had a reputation for having products to sell, being among the first in the country to be allocated goods. The immediate effect from this was long queues, even for ordinary items. And what did that shopping experience look like once at the front of the line? Well, the process to purchase an item was one which certainly didn't help any queues to move quickly. Shoppers found themselves having to wait in three separate queues. The first line was to be able to tell the salesperson what item the shopper wanted to purchase, and then to confirm the price of the item. The shopper would then queue in a second line from which they would pay their money to a cashier who would provide them with a bill of sale indicating the amount that had been paid. The third line would then be for a different salesperson who would check the bill of sale and then, if everything was in alignment, would provide the shopper with the item they wanted. This time-intensive and highly inefficient system was designed to not only create jobs for people, but also to help prevent opportunity for any petty corruption between the shopper and the salesperson. Now, the inefficiencies and inconveniences in this system were somewhat alleviated starting in 1970, first in Leningrad and then Moscow, and then extending to other major Soviet cities with the opening of the Universam stores. These stores resembled a modern supermarket, where shoppers could browse and gather their own items, unsupervised, and then pay for them at a cash register. This concept, likely commonplace for most of us now, was deemed quite novel at the time and had been something Khrushchev was taken by on his 1959 visit to the United States. It's important to point out, however, that the Universams, like the CUMs and GUMs, were really only options to residents of large cities in the Soviet Union. Even in the big cities, many citizens relied on smaller stores for their shopping needs, especially for items like dairy, meat, or bakery goods. In the smaller cities and towns, these were often the only way to shop. Okay, so we've established where people shopped, but what good is a shop if it doesn't have any products to sell? Shortages were a fairly common occurrence and stemmed from the nature of a planned economy and Soviet economic policy. For those who may not be familiar, in a planned economy, all production in all industries was based on a plan, running over the course of years, which required each industry to hit certain quotas of goods. Any disruption in the achieving of the quotas could and would have impacts on other parts of the economy, which depended on the goods being produced. For example, if in year one of the plan, 100 units of shoe leather were called for, but only 90 units were produced, the target of 100 units of shoes that were called for in year two of the plan would not be achievable. So it became very important for quotas to be met at every stage of production, so much so that a person's career could be at stake if the quotas were not met. This led to something called careerism, the falsification of production data in order to protect your own job. This falsification happened in addition to corruption and sometimes outright theft of goods, and all of it added up to shortfalls in real production. Of course, this wasn't the only challenge that led to shortfalls. Another contributing factor was Soviet pricing policies. Prices of all products, including food, were set by the central government and were very rarely raised. People's salaries, however, did gradually increase over time. And how were these wage increases paid for? Well, Moscow just printed more money. This led to something called hidden inflation. The currency lost its purchasing power as the price of goods was not allowed to fluctuate according to market conditions. But it also meant that firms produced less in order to cover the cost of wage increases. To see the real effects of this hidden inflation, we only need to look at pricing at the local markets where people bought and sold food items that had been grown privately on people's allotments, small areas of land that were privately held and were usually located not too far from where people lived. The goods grown on these allotments were sold in markets that were not regulated by the government and therefore reflected real market prices, which were normally significantly higher than the prices found in state-run stores. For those of you interested in these markets, they were technically illegal, but tolerated by the state as they helped to alleviate the seemingly omnipresent food shortage problem in the country. But back to goods shortages, these became more pronounced starting the 1960s and by the 1980s were particularly frequent as the weakness of the Soviet economy became inescapable. People would find themselves standing in queues for hours, waiting or just hoping to be able to buy food items. It was commonplace for people to always carry an avoska, a reusable string bag, in case they came across a line that they could join. It was not unheard of for people to join a line and only then try and find out what they were lining up for. Rationing was even introduced in the 1980s to help ensure some distribution to the people, and this included the big cities, like Moscow and Leningrad, which typically were the last to feel the negative impacts of economic troubles. Now, just to be clear, the decision to introduce rationing in the 1980s was the result of a combination of multiple factors. Poor and late harvests, the US embargo, hidden inflation, poor storage capacity, all of these things led to dwindling food supplies. The rationing was implemented either through the use of ration coupons issued to citizens or simply by shops restricting the amount of an item a person or family was allowed to buy. This is all pretty damning stuff and could make life complicated and difficult. But to quote Jeff Goldblum, life finds a way. And this was the growth of the black market or the use of foreign currency stores for those who could access them. So let's talk about the foreign currency stores first. Stalin's death in 1953 and Khrushchev's thaw that followed led to an expansion of Soviet contact and exchange with countries around the world. Coupled with this was a rapid growth in the number of new nations as the decolonization process took hold. The Soviet pursuit of new relationships led to the establishment of new embassies, consulates, and trade missions, as well as the dispatch of scientific and engineering delegations to any country that was interested in pursuing a relationship with the Soviet Union. The wages of these Soviet workers sent abroad were paid in foreign currencies, not rubles, which often had greater purchasing power back home. Let's also keep in mind that this is the same period where foreign tourist travel to the Soviet Union was being encouraged, largely in a bid to capture those sweet, sweet foreign currency reserves. And why, may you ask, did the Soviet Union, a superpower with the ability to destroy the planet, need that foreign currency? Well, it was so it could pay for its foreign imports. The Soviet Union, even with its satellite states, was not autarkic and relied on imports to keep its people fed and its economy moving, however stagnant. This wasn't a new phenomenon either. In the 1930s, there had been the trade with foreigners' stores, commonly referred to as torgsins. These had run between 1931 and 1936 and had allowed citizens to purchase goods in exchange for foreign currency or even precious metals and jewelry. Of course, we should point out that these stores sold primarily food items and were designed to take valuable assets away from the people in exchange for enough food to prevent starvation. But by the time that Khrushchev was in power, the idea of foreign currency stores was revived, but with a less sinister format. Two chains were opened, what were known as the Beryozka, where foreign currency could be used to purchase goods as needed. The name of the store could vary from region to region, Gashtan in Ukraine or Dzintars in Latvia, for example, but generally the name Beryozka was applied and became synonymous with the stores. The story of these stores goes back to 1958 when the Council of Ministers of the Soviet Union allowed for Soviet citizens working abroad to open foreign currency bank accounts through the Vnyeshtorgbank, the foreign trade bank. Starting from the early 1960s, a chain of Beryozka stores was opened that took payment in foreign currency directly or via checks drawn on accounts from the Vnyeshtorgbank. For those without a foreign currency account, but who, for whatever reason, held some amount of foreign currency, it could be exchanged for certificates known as Vnyeshposilturg, which themselves were denominated in rubles. The certificates were highly sought after. For example, in 1967, some foreign workers would save up to 40% of their salaries in order to obtain them due to their purchasing power and the quality of goods that could be purchased using them. By 1965, more than 100 Beryozka stores had been opened across the Soviet Union, located in the capitals of the republics and in the major cities of Russia and Ukraine. There was a constantly growing demand for the Beryozkas, which can be seen in the rise in equity capital of the Vnyeshpolistorg, which went from 1 million rubles in 1965 to 5 million rubles by 1979. And what were people buying? Well, from the available statistics from the Moscow Beryozki, for 1970, half of all revenues were from car sales, with clothing purchases ranked second at a distant 20%. This was followed by perfume and cosmetics with 6% of revenue, food purchases at 5.3%, and appliances at 3.2%. So you might have expected food purchases to be ranked higher? Well, a few notes on that. These stats were based on revenue, where food would have been less lucrative for the store. But more importantly, not only was this in Moscow, where shortages were less likely to happen, but the people who had the ability to access the Beryozka were normally the Soviet elite and had better access to general goods and used the Beryozka to obtain luxury foodstuffs. Back to the statistics on the goods sold, 75% of those products sold through the Moscow Beryozka were imported goods, while the remaining 25% were Soviet-made items intended for export, so met higher quality standards than goods destined for the domestic market. And the stores were popular. In 1978, the turnover in the Moscow Vnyeshpolistorg stores was 257.6 million rubles, with a profit of 5.6 million rubles. Only a year later, this had increased to 274.4 million rubles, with a profit of 8 million rubles, and by 1984, they had a turnover of 325 million rubles and made a profit of 13.6 million. That is a lot of kasha. So, who shopped at the Beryozka stores? Well, foreigners who had foreign currency, naturally, but that was a small percentage of business. Most Beryozka customers were Soviet citizens who earned money while abroad. They could be working as diplomats, as foreign correspondents for Soviet newspapers, as specialists or engineers. All of these positions were coveted not only for the ability to travel abroad, but the opportunity to earn foreign currency, which could be saved and brought home to be used at Beryozka. There were two major advantages of shopping there: time and quality. For example, I just mentioned that 50% of revenue was through the sale of cars. This was because instead of having to wait possibly for years for a car through the regular process, a car could be purchased almost immediately through the Berioska. And the models bought would be ones destined for export, with slightly more powerful engines, or nicer trim levels and features, like four headlights instead of only two. And buying a car this way proved to be a popular option for those who could take advantage. In 1970, the Moscow branch of the Dniezhpolstorg sold 7% of all cars sold in the Soviet Union that year. Okay, so what other goods were being purchased through the Berioska? Well, household technology items were very popular as well. With Khrushchev's push to increase housing, millions of Soviet citizens found themselves in need, or in want, of things like TV sets, cameras, vacuum cleaners, refrigerators, and other items of otherwise convenience. These types of items were readily available for purchase at the Berioska. Initially, it was only Soviet-made brands, but after 1965, imported goods also became available with their reputation for better quality. And this wasn't just tech goods, but also things like furniture, clothing, and food. And where were these goods coming from? Well, they were coming from other East Bloc nations, like Czechoslovakia, East Germany, and Hungary, all of whom had reputations for higher quality manufacturing than that found in the Soviet Union. So, the Berioskas were popular, but, and here is the but that at least some of you have been waiting for, the Berioskas weren't an option for most citizens. In order to shop there, people had to have access to foreign currency, which was very difficult in the controlled nature of the Soviet Union. One thing we didn't mention was that the foreign currency certificates were non-transferable between citizens. Ivan, the lathe turner from Gorky, who had never left his own oblast and had no foreign or party connections, had no access to foreign currency, unless he went to the black market, but that ran a series of risks of its own, with a variety of potential consequences. So that neat little transition does bring us to that perennial outlet of Soviet shopping, the black market. Generally, if somebody needed something that was unavailable in shops, or the buyer was not willing to wait for hours to get the item, they could deal with a farsovshik, a black market dealer. Goods available could range from American jeans to Yugoslavian boots to sausages, depending on how connected the farsovshik happened to be. Of course, these black market traders were conducting illegal activity, but normally operated under the protection of local party bosses and even the Soviet economic police. And why would these people in positions of power and influence provide protection for people breaking the law? Why, for bribes, of course. What better way to supplement your income than accepting payoffs to ignore or even protect illegal activity? But it wasn't just about the bribes, although those were important. Thanks to the chronic shortages, which got worse over time, the black market also provided an outlet for Soviet citizens to purchase needed items. The authorities recognized that if they enforced the letter of the law and shut down the farsovshik, they would have to face angry citizens unable to get even the basics of life. By the end of the Soviet Union, the Soviet Interior Ministry estimated that the annual turnover of the black market was somewhere between 110 and 130 billion rubles per year. That is also a lot of kasha. So, that's a look at Soviet shopping. In a society that preached equality for all, a two-tier system emerged, with the top tier only being accessible to the privileged. As the economy stagnated and mismanagement and corruption took hold, shortages became more and more frequent, forcing people into the grossly inefficient and unproductive system of queuing or driving them to make purchases on the black market, something which robbed the state of revenue and therefore exacerbated and magnified the problems in the command economy which drove the shortages in the first place. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have brought your Avoska with you in case you see a line you can join which may be selling access to the bell button. Once you've found out how much the bell button is, then you can queue to pay for the bell button, and then, and only then, can you line up again to show your receipt to the salesperson so that you can now press the bell button. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. And we're active on Facebook and Instagram at The Cold War TV. If you enjoy our work, your financial support would be greatly appreciated via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. This is the Cold War channel, and don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it becomes heated.